To those who know and love Bach's Passion according to St. Matthew, it is a revered masterpiece, perhaps one of the divine dozen in all musical literature. But there are many people, unfortunately, for whom this work seems more like some sort of challenge seen dimly through a mist of unappetizing words like oratorio, cantata, canon, fugue, chorale, aria, and whatnot. This mist of words, which sounds so undramatic and technical, must be dispelled, for as soon as it is dispelled, there is revealed a work of such dramatic power and invention as has seldom, if ever, been equaled. Whoever said Bach was undramatic? In the very opening chorus, before the narrator has even begun to tell the story, the drama is already laid before us as tellingly as in the opening of a Greek tragedy. This is the orchestral introduction which sets the mood of suffering and pain, preparing for the entrance of the chorus which will sing the agonized sorrow of the faithful at the moment of crucifixion. And this is all done in imitation, in canon. Come ye daughters, share my anguish, sing the basses. They are answered in canon a fifth higher by the tenors. And at the same time, the female voices are singing a counter canon of their own. The sopranos are singing. And they are answered by the altos. The resulting richness of all the parts, with the orchestra throbbing beneath, is incomparable. Then suddenly the chorus breaks into two antiphonal choruses. See him, cries the first one. Whom, asks the second, and the first chorus answers, the bridegroom, see him. How? So like a lamb. And then over and against all this questioning and answering and throbbing, the voices of a boy's choir sing out the chorale tune, O Lamb of God Most Holy, piercing through the worldly pain with the icy clear truth of redemption. The contrapuntal combination of the three different choruses is thrilling. There's nothing like it in all music. See, for Bach, nothing could exceed in pity, terror, or exaltation the simple story of Christ and the wonder of man's relation to him. And it is here in the drama of Christianity that Bach's dramatic genius burns most brightly. For example, throughout the St. Matthew Passion, the events of the Passion play are sung by a solo tenor in the barest recitativo style, accompanied only by a harpsichord, a cello, and a bass. But when the voice of Jesus is heard, even in the recitativo passages, the strings enter and surround it with glowing chords, which have often been compared to a halo. Here is such a recitativo section describing the scene of the Last Supper, where Jesus tells his disciples that one of them will betray him, and listen for that halo in the strings.
He sat down to eat with the 12. he said as they were eating,
verily I say to you, one of you shall betray me.
Then there follows one of the most dramatic moments of the whole work, as the disciples' voices tumble over one another in the fearful, anxious question, Lord, is it I? Here is a pure dramatic use of counterpoint, which makes the scene as real as if it were being acted. There's a fascinating sidelight to this little chorus. It turns out that the phrase, Lord, is it I, is repeated exactly 11 times, once for each of the disciples, except Judas, who is understandably silent. But this is not only a dramatic device. It reflects Bach's tremendous preoccupation with symbols, whether numerological or pictorial. Bach was a mystic for all his plain provincial Lutheran simplicity, and this almost naive mystic streak shows up all through the Passion in the form of musical pictorialism. To Bach, notes were not just sounds, but the very stuff of creation, and if he could use them to shape the cross or to depict a gesture of Christ's hand or to suggest the flight of the Spirit to heaven, then he was happy. For example, take this recitativo later on in the Passion.
And when they had sung an hymn of praise together, they went out unto the Mount of Olives.
Did you hear that slow ascent to the Mount of Olives? And then he gives us a lyrical image of the ascension to heaven through another simple scale. But how different is this scale, with its halo of strings, from the dry harpsichord one depicting the ascent to the Mount of Olives? We begin to see now what the great Albert Schweitzer calls Bach's tone speech, by which he means that mystic fusion of words and notes that resulted in a whole new Bachian language. It is in this language that Bach writes his drama, not only in the recitativo sections where the story is being told, but everywhere in the Passion. For example, in the Gethsemane scene, when Jesus finds his disciples sleeping, he says, What, could ye not watch with me 1 hour? Watch ye, and pray ye enter not into temptation. And he continues,
The Spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak.
How wonderful is the setting of that word weak. You are expecting a normal resolution of the harmony, like this. But the flesh is weak. But Bach paints the word for us by using an irresolute chord. But the flesh is weak. Can you feel the weakness of the harmony? And as for word painting, nothing excels the moment of betrayal when Judas kisses his master. The kiss, with all its fake sweetness, is made almost visual to us in an over-romanticized phrase.
And straightway came he to Jesus and said,
All hail to thee, O Master.
The moment when Jesus is captured is signalized by one of the great set pieces of the whole work, a duet for soprano and alto with choral backing on the words, "Alas, my Savior now is taken." This is no longer just word painting, but scene painting on the largest scale. It's like one of those great choruses in Greek tragedy. The two solo singers are like the chorus leaders, and as their contrapuntal lament spins out, it is broken into by startling cries of "Leave him, bind him not," from the chorus of the faithful. Then, as the soloists sing, "He's led away, ah, they have bound him," we hear heavy measured treads in the orchestra. As of inexorable footsteps. And then it all erupts in a tremendous choral outburst, calling on the lightning and thunder to destroy these murderers. After hearing this fugal chorus, no one can ever again say that counterpoint is dull. This is drama at the boiling point. Pure drama on the highest level, the Bachian level. And on through the work, with unbelievable consistency, this level is maintained, as in the moment when Pontius Pilate offers the mob their choice of Barabbas or Jesus to be released.
Tell me whether of the twain he will, that I release to you. They answered,
Or listen to this setting of the last heartbreaking moment on the cross.
And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried aloud and said,
Did you notice that this time Jesus' words are not framed by a halo of strings? And this is the only time in the Passion that this is true. And it's a masterstroke, for at this one moment of death, Christ is mortal. And now there follows the most dramatic moment of all.
And then behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top unto the bottom.
And finally, the concluding chorus, the farewell to Christ in the tomb, like a great exalted lullaby. I wish it were possible to show you all the wonders of this work, but they are infinite. Nobody knows them all, even with a lifetime of study. But that's the way with great masterpieces. They present a vision that is infinitely rewarding because they are conceived in infinite depth and faith. So it is with the St. Matthew Passion. And as you listen to it, may you be similarly rewarded.